Dear colleagues, dear friends, it is with great pleasure that I take the opportunity also on behalf of the other organizers to open this meeting, a mathematical tribute to Ennio De Giorgio. I'm doing this with some emotion. First of all, as a professor of the Scuola Normale, the institution where De Giorgio has been teaching and also living for almost 40 years, but also as a former student of Ennio De Giorgio. Well, I think that the number of participants to this meeting is the most visible sign of the strength of Ennio De Giorgio's heritage in mathematics, but also in many more aspects of life. Of course, many of us had the chance to meet him and to work with him, but now, after 20 years, we have new generations of mathematicians who didn't. And this is one of the reasons behind this event, which is a scientific meeting, but also an occasion to speak a bit about him. And in this connection, I also wish to mention that tomorrow in the afternoon, we will display parts of Michele Emmer's interview to Ennio De Giorgi. And I thank warmly Michele Emmer for giving us this opportunity. To close, let me thank the sponsors of this event. As many of you know, the Scuola Normale established a few years after De Giorgi's departure a Centro di Ricerca Matematica directed from the foundation in 2001 until 2013 by Mariano Giaquinta. And this event is made possible by the funding and the very, very efficient staff of the Centro De Giorgi, with important contributions also coming from NIAMPA, INDAM, the Istituto Nazionale di Alta Matematica, and from two ERC grants. And I think I can stop here, and I now pass the word to Stefano Marmi, the present director of the Centro De Giorgi.
Okay, so welcome to Pisa. I'm presently the director of the Giorgi Center, which is a reality which has been created by the Scuola Normale jointly with the Università di Pisa and the Scuola Sant'Anna in 2001. So we will spend a week appreciating the huge scientific legacy of De Giorgi, but there is a legacy which goes beyond the mathematics that he has been doing and that will be celebrated by the people giving talks and chatting in the hall and in the corridors around, and which goes beyond this, because the Giorgi Center is a reality which has been made possible by the strength of the impact that mathematics has in Pisa, and certainly the Giorgi was second to nobody in giving intensity to the research in mathematics in Pisa. So since 2013, I'm directing this center, which was created, as Luigi mentioned, in 2001. Just a few words. I mean, every year we have about 1,000 visitors for many activities. We organized about 10 or 15 workshops, schools, and both in pure mathematics and in various applications of mathematics. And every year we also give three or four, depending on the funding available, postdoc positions. This is something that most colleagues here know. Many people who are here have also profited from this, and many people, I hope, will apply and get these positions in the future. I think this is all what I wanted to say. Let me just thank the organizers of the conference for the fantastic work they have done in assembling the conference and such a remarkable list of speakers and topics. And at the same time, let me also thank for the work that have been doing preparing the conference and that will be doing during the conference and after the conference all the secretaries of the center, Caterina Delia, Silvia Quaglieri and Antonella Gregorace. You have already met them. You will have constant help from them. And if all the activities we do run smoothly, is basically due to the great value of the organizers and to the extraordinary work which is made by the secretaries of the center.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you. Well, now I introduce Antonio Leacci, one of the organizers of this event. He will speak also on behalf of the director of the Dipartimento di Matematica e Fisica, Ennio De Giorgi, of Lecce University.
Thank you, Luigi. Thank you. Welcome to all lecturers and participants. I want to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak about Ennio De Giorgi and Lecce. From now on, I shall use just first names in order to avoid difficulties. So I told about Ennio. I was never able to call him so when he was alive, but now it seems to me almost necessary. Here you can see Ennio with his brother Mario, which was the elder, and the sister Rosa. Mario disappeared in 1999, 3 years after Ennio. Rosa is with us, and I read a message from her. This is the handwritten message in Italian, and I translate in English. I live in Lecce with my family. I am Rosa, the sister more than 90 of Ennio, the youngest of 3 siblings who remained fatherless at an early age. I thank the organizers of this important initiative, and I have a vivid memory of the fondness from which every time I was in Pisa, so surrounded Ennio, and think back to those last days. All we alternate moved to his bedside. I wish all the participants at this conference, both to those who personally met my brother Ennio, and to the youngest, a fruitful work in the memory of a great scientist and an extraordinary man. This is the message from the sister Rosa. The next message is by Annadina, daughter of Mario. She is a lawyer specialized in marriage problems. He would like to be here, but she has many judicial hearings this week. So I invite the nephew Francesco Baglivo to read the message of Annadina.
Pisa, September to October, 20 years ago, a living memory of fear. In the family, we all loved Uncle Ennio, who loved us all. Of the nephews and nieces, I was the one who could get to Pisa first, so I went there. Ennio was in hospital. He was very ill, and I was allowed to stay with him only a few minutes. Fear, a feeling of helplessness. But immediately, my fear, my suffering, were lessened because I was surrounded but by the kindness, the care, and the affection of his friends, the mathematicians, the professors of the Scuola Normale, who were in Pisa and by their families. My uncle was loved, and those who loved him were loved by him and gave me their love, his niece. They accompanied me when I went to the hospital, and they waited for me when I came out. They supported me and helped me in every way. I found help and solidarity also in the personnel of the Scuola Normale and of the Timpano, with whom I discovered Ennio had a truly friendly relationship. I was helped and supported until that terrible Friday afternoon. I was organizing his return to Lecce for his convalescence and for his accommodation at the Timpano for when he returned to Pisa, but instead I organized his funeral, and afterwards his friends helped me and supported me. 20 years have gone by and I'll still suffer for his loss. But the memory of my uncle still remains alive for me and for the members of my family. He was, above all, a man who knew how to love people. I see that this memory lives on also in the mathematical community. Those who receive love from him continue to give it to the others. Love for others, for every man, love for knowledge. On behalf of my family, thank you, because our uncle lives every time that you live what he passed on you through his life.
Thank you. I want to say that Francesco is a student here in Pisa in medicine at the Scuola Superiore Sant'Anna, together with the normal school, is an excellence center. So even the new generations of familiars of the Giorgi are very promising, two generations after Ennio. Now I shall say something about De Giorgi and Lecce, which is the theme of my talk. As you can see, here is Pisa and here is Lecce, in between the two sea, Ionian Sea and Adriatic Sea, in the tip of Puglia. Lecce has 95,000 residents at about 900 kilometers from Pisa. I want to start recalling the paper wrote by Jacques-Louis Lyons and François Murat, first in France and after on the notices of the IMS in October 1997. They started recalling just in the first lines that Ennio De Giorgi was born in Lecce, a city of Puglia, with which he always maintained deep ties. And I wanted to say something about this. Last year has been published a book by Andrea Parlangeli about the life of Ennio De Giorgi. The first edition is sold out, but now, tomorrow, I think, Andrea will come with the second revised edition of this book. An e-book version is disposable on the internet. In the book, you can find many, many other notices about the life of De Giorgi. So I start with the grandfather of Ennio, Salvatore. The family of De Giorgi came originally from Lizzanello, a small city near Lecce, 6 or 7 kilometers. In Lizzanello, Mario was even mayor. And in Lizzanello, there is a building entitled to Ennio De Giorgi. In Lizzanello, we have also a couple of meetings on geometric measure theory and partial differential equations. Salvatore was a notary in Lizzanello, and he moved for professional reasons in the main town, Lecce. The grand uncle Cosimo was born in Lizzanello 1842, and he died in Lecce in 1922. Throughout his life, he added to the medical profession that of a teacher. Besides this, he developed an intensive research and study activity, reflecting the full breadth of his cultural interests: paleontology, palethnology, archaeology, geography, geology, seismology, and so on. Cosimo De Giorgi was also the inventor of a seismograph that bears his name. This work earned him in 1880 his appointment as Knight of the Crown of Italy. At that time in Italy there was monarchy, we had the king. The first scientific high school in Lecce is named after Cosimo. Since 2015, the Aula Magna is dedicated to Ennio De Giorgi. We see here Annadina at the entitlement of the Aula to Ennio De Giorgi. And here you can see a photogram from the video that we shall see tomorrow. This is the scientific high school Cosimo De Giorgi in Lecce. This is the main building. This is the branch building. Inside this building, there is the Aula Magna Ennio De Giorgi. The parents, Nicola and Stefania. Unfortunately, Nicola died very early. The mother, Stefania, instead died in 1988 at the age of 99. Nicola was a teacher, but he had many other interests. For instance, he studied deeply Arabic language and also geography and history. This is the house of Ennio's family. Ennio was born here in this building on February 8 in 1928, at the first floor of this building. This balcony is a part of the apartment of Ennio. And he remained as a residence for all his life there. He never changed. This building is in the center of the city of Lecce. Beside the main museum and near many other important buildings and even near our rectorate. Here you can see Ennio giving a talk at the Scientific High School Cosimo De Giorgi in 1963. The talk was about mathematics and the modern world. In 1963, Ennio underlined the importance of the use of computers that will reshape the way to do mathematics. This is in 1963, a long time ago. Ennio De Giorgi was member of the committee for the establishment of the Faculty of Sciences in Lecce, together with two physicists, Alberto Bonetti from Florence, Niccolò Dalla Porta from Padova and De Sissa in Trieste. Since then, he has always remained a kind of guardian angel for the faculty and the whole University of Lecce, now University of Salento, Salento is the area around Lecce. There was many prizes given in Lecce to Ennio. Here you can see maybe the most relevant, maybe, the prize Targa Santa Cesarea in 1976. You can see here, together with Ennio, Professor Raffaele Spongano, which was an expert of Italian language and was a professor in Bologna and even at the Columbia University in New York. But here you can see Aldo Moro. Aldo Moro was one of the most relevant personalities in the Christian Democratic Party in Italy. He was two times prime minister, and he was killed in 1978, 2 years later, by the Italian terrorists of the Red Brigades. Then we have other recognitions. Here you can see Ennio at a international conference on Descartes in 1987. Here you can see Mario, and here you can see Ludovico Geymonat, one of the most relevant Italian expert of philosophy of science, and also the father of the mathematician Giuseppe Geymonat. Here is another conference. As I said, Ennio was a kind of guardian angel for all of us. He participated to this international conference on differential geometry in Lecce in 1989. You see him here. Some colleagues from Florence maybe recognize Franco Tricerri, just at the left of Ennio. Then the University of Lecce awarded Ennio with the Laurea Honoris Causa in philosophy, and he was very proud of this kind of recognition for his deep interest in human rights and many other philosophical issues. Here there is the department in Lecce. You have seen before Ennio in front of this department. In 1997, this was dedicated to him. Here is a picture of the day of the dedication. Many colleagues are present even here today. Since 2012, for financial reasons and membership of professors, the department was unified with the physicists. And here we have the Department of Mathematics and Physics Ennio De Giorgi. And altogether, mathematicians and physicists are very proud to work in the Dipartimento di Matematica e Fisica Ennio De Giorgi. Thank you.
Thank you, Antonio. Now I am happy to introduce Luciano Modica, who will close this preliminary part of the meeting.
20 years ago, as rector of the University of Pisa, I pronounced a speech at the funeral of Ennio De Giorgi in the splendid Scuola Normale cloister. I was deeply touched, as well as hundreds of people from all Italy who crowded the cloister. Not only an irreplaceable mathematician and a friend of mine was just and prematurely died, but also a charismatic figure of world mathematics and of the whole Italian academic community. My words were not only those ones of a student of Ennio, but also of the entire University of Pisa, which was saying by me the farewell to a professor of Scuola Normale who had ever had direct and constant scientific relations with the colleagues of the university. Today, I am here for remembering him again, touched as 20 years ago. I am very grateful to Luigi Ambrosio, to Stefano Marmi, and to all organizing committee of this tribute to De Giorgi for inviting me to give these few words. No more to represent the University of Pisa, but to testify once more that the city, the university, the Department of Mathematics, the friends did not forget Ennio and his leading role in making Pisa one of the citadels of advanced mathematical research and of marvelous, always new discoveries in our discipline. Many years ago, I abandoned active mathematics for politics. So I left the national and international community of colleagues and friends. However, I still recognize myself as fully participating in such community. And to find again here so many friends and colleagues of that time, and also so many young colleagues, analysts, is another gift I am receiving by Ennio. So, no farewell speech today, but a thanksgiving for what he gave us and left us, not only in mathematics. He was a giant of mathematics, of culture, of civil ethics, of religious thought. In the last 20 years, his figure towered over more and more, recalled countlessly in books, papers, interviews, films, till the recent, already quoted, beautiful biography written by Andrea Parlangeli. It is moving to see Ennio in the videos of the last interviews, only a few weeks before his death, with his unique style, the white shirt without tie, the jacket pulled up continuously by his own hands, the mild accent from Lecce, the typical interjections, ecco, and above all, the quietness, might the sweetness, together with the self-confidence in expressing his points of view, pondered for a long time, and then made concise, essential, terse, deprived of any rhetoric, how it is appropriate for one who is used to prove, to state and to prove theorems. He had an insatiable intellectual curiosity all around. He liked the knowledge, the wisdom, or the wisdom with the capital letter W, as requested by his deep religious faith. Any cultural topic appeared to be interesting for him, not for a useless encyclopedic attitude, but for the sake of knowledge, and also because it was a way for establishing intellectual and personal relationships with anyone who is a repository of some particular knowledge. His knowledge came more from conversations than from readings. He was a tireless good talker. Let me remind a tiny personal event. In 1968, I came to Pisa for the admission exams to Scuola Normale. The evening before, my parents brought me for dinner in a famous restaurant in Pisa. I don't remember anything of that dinner, of course, except for a man who, seated in the near table, stood out for his strange voice, speaking aloud during all dinner about the birds of Ethiopian fauna. He seemed us very odd, but after some weeks, it was a great surprise for me to see him again as a professor in my class and as a very famous mathematician at the peak of the scientific success. I have reminded this meaningless event not only for showing the unlimited desire of knowledge and the conversation which marked Ennio, and that nobody who knew him can forget, but even because it allows me to quote, to introduce another feature of his personality. At the end of the 60s, Ennio was spending some summer weeks in teaching elementary mathematics at a small university managed by Catholic sisters in Asmara, Ethiopia. His motivation appears to be somewhat prophetic with respect to today's problems. He firmly believed that the contact between different among different cultures heals the deepest and more revolutionary, innovative, and long-lasting progresses of science. Understanding and friendship among persons with different own cultures, he said, are the only strong roots of knowledge and peace, because tolerance is a poor sentiment, friendship is a rich one. In fact, he liked very much to become a friend of his students and colleagues. Coming from South Italy, he liked also the familiar dimension, that one of his very beloved own family, and those ones of the families of his students and friends, whose houses he was frequently a guest, and where he spent afternoons, dinners, and after dinners, participating with an extreme discretion, but also with a warm feeling in any event or problem of them, of spouses, of children. Curiosity and friendship were joined and realized in his clear refusal of any intellectual arrogance. Of course, he was perfectly conscious of the terrific scientific value of his ideas and theorems, of the breach he had opened in mathematical unsurmountable walls, but he never boasted. On the contrary, he was ready to accept also routine mathematical tasks, for instance, to teach courses often unwelcome and refused by other less famous mathematicians, with an admirable willingness and an extraordinary talent for transforming the more usual content of a lesson in an experience of high ingenuity. A new point of view, a new shape or order in the presentation, a new proof, all to highlight suddenly hidden and interesting aspects of traditional subjects. Until the last minute before entering in the classroom, he prepared the lesson, scribbling all over his notepad unreadable mathematical hieroglyphics, by which he was settling those ideas which have bloomed naturally in his mind and that he wanted to transfer to students with the immediacy of the direct creativity at the blackboard, well known to all of us. As an example, I can quote a historical course of elementary calculus held for students in chemistry, or by direct experience, the course in elementary linear algebra he taught to the first year students of Scuola Normale was, I still keep the notes typed by some keen students. Satisfied by the scientific success of his school, in a really Socratic sense of the term school, he never wanted to accept academic offices, never, nor to participate in selection or assessment committees, with a very few exceptions during his life. Nevertheless, he was very able to evaluate accurately and cleverly the talent of young mathematicians without the rigidities and technicalities of nowadays. For him, to evaluate did not mean to reward or to punish someone, but to make the most of everyone. Assessment for growth, not for rankings. In fact, another feature of his nature was generosity. He was generous of his time and ideas, as well as friendly and sympathetic. When he had opened a new road in an unexplored and unknown mathematical panorama, he left that other mathematicians cover and turn over the fruitful lands he had offered to research, and he was sincerely glad of their results. To his students, he proposed the problems perfectly calibrated with their capabilities. If someone bumped into some difficulties which seemed unsolvable, he discreetly suggested the ways for going beyond. For many of the George's pupils, this disinterested generosity is a seal of his training, engraved in their mind and behavior, and used in any circumstance. He lived a free man, but strongly respectful of all other people. He was free from social conventions, free of dreaming, envisaging, combining different concepts, and so, these are his words, to bring to light or visibility some grains of the enormous mass of invisible things plunged in the dark. Mathematics was for him a bridge between the small seashore of the known and the very large ocean of the unknown. He was a religious person and did not judge as unreasonable the effectiveness of mathematics, the famous sentence by Eugen Wigner. in constructing structures and theories which explain a plurality of phenomena. Because for him, this was only the sign that, as Bible writes, wisdom is found by those who keep seeking after her and readily appears to those who love her. Philos Sophiae. For all of us, mathematics is anyway a great human adventure. The adventure of men and women who, with fantasy and flawless rigor, with friendship, respect, sympathy, generosity, reciprocal confidence, erect altogether the big building of truth. I am sure that Ennio De Giorgi would agree. Thank you.